Sí. Okay, welcome everyone to this Zooming in conversation organized on the occasion of Shigeru Onishi's exhibition at FOAM. Titled The Possibility of Existence, the exhibition was curated by Miriam Koyman and presents the extraordinary yet forgotten work of this Japanese artist and mathematician. My name is Valeria Posada. I work as project coordinator at FOAM, and I will be the moderator for this session. Together with gallery director Katsuya Ishida and art critic Vicente Todolí, we will discuss the rediscovery of Onishi's work within and out of Japan. We hope to transmit our enthusiasm and interest in his photographic vision and inspire you, of course, on your lunch break or dinner break. Without further ado, I would like to give Katsuya and Vicente the floor so they can briefly introduce themselves and explain their connection to this exhibition. Katsuya?
Okay, thank you, Valeria. Thank you for having me. It's the first I thank the FOAM to organize this fantastic exhibition of Onishi, the first museum exhibition exhibiting his photographs outside of Japan. I'm a gallery director. My name is Katsuya Ishida. I'm a gallery director of MEM based in Ebisu, Tokyo. We show contemporary and modern art and photography, and we focus on especially Japanese modern photography movements in pre-war and early post-war period. And well, that's it.
Vicente.
Yes, well, really, I'm not an art critic. I don't write about art. I'm a museum director, an independent curator, and a collection advisor. I directed Ivan Centro Coli Gonzalez in Valencia, then Serravez Museum in Porto, Tate Modern in London, and now I'm director of Pirelli and Garbigo in Milano, but I'm the advisor for Bomba's Hands, both for the program and the collection. And that's what brings me here.
Thank you so much, Vicente. Thank you so much, Katsuya, for the introduction. And I would really like to, I'm excited to delve into the conversation, but before I would like to give a short introduction on Shigeru Onishi. So who is exactly Shigeru Onishi? Shigeru Onishi was born in Hokkaido in 1928, that is in the northern tip of Japan. After he graduated in 1953 from Hokkaido's University Department of Mathematics, he stayed at the same university to do further research on topology, which is a branch of mathematics. And around the same time, he became interested in photography and he joined the Sapporo Amateur Photo Club, then started to apply his mathematical theories to the image making process. And though he switched from photography to ink painting or bokusho around 1957, so just 4 years after, this short and intense lived period experience produced a unique oeuvre. Onishi's works were focused on exploring the expressive and creative possibilities of photography, of going beyond its documentary aspect. As he eloquently stated in the periodical Photo 35 in 1953, for him, it was, and I open quotes, crucial to form images of things rid of all constraints, including the dictates of mathematics and the physics of time and space, to obtain results that are beyond one's calculations. This interest led him to approach the darkroom in a strikingly different way than his contemporaries. In a time where photographers strive to achieve clear and clean images that could successfully hide the work of the camera and the developing process, he did the contrary. He was fascinated with photomontage and employed unorthodox printing methods, including multiple exposure, superimposition, solarization, intentional fogging, and discoloration. Onishi's work featured in some of the avant-garde exhibitions in Japan and Europe. But as photography historian Ryūichi Kaneko stated, Shigeru Onishi never found a place for himself there. He did earn praise on some occasions, but his photographic output was almost totally overlooked in comparison to the works in abstract ink that he developed afterwards. When Shigeru Onishi died in December 1994, his photographic prints were soon forgotten. But, however, with the work of Ryūichi Kaneko, the photography historian, and Katsuya Ishida, the photographs are getting the space to be seen and to be valued. And this effort, of course, has paid off. The exhibition in Foam is the first international solo exhibition of his photographic works outside of Japan. And it was developed in collaboration with Bombas Gens Art Center in Valencia and curated by the here present Vicente Todolí. So having given the short introduction, I would like to get the conversation going. Katsuya, I previously mentioned that it was due to you and the photography historian Ryūichi Kaneko's effort that Onishi's overlooked over got the much deserved spotlight. But I would like to know more about how this connection came to be. Can you tell us more how you got acquainted with the photo with Onishi's work? Where did you and Kaneko discover Onishi's forgotten prints?
Well, it's kind of a long story in the detail, but as I explained, we regularly hold exhibitions focusing on Japanese modern photography movements, especially avant-garde photo movements in the 30s, 40s, and the 50s. And I regularly consulted with Mr. Kaneko about our gallery programs, which he supervised. And we feature amateur photo clubs that were instrumental in the development of Japanese avant-garde photo movements in the 30s. Then one day Mr. Kaneko showed me the photographs in boxes, you know, that were by Shigeru Onishi and at his house. And I was so shocked. I was so impressed by the body of photographs by Onishi. Although I had not heard of him, I never had any knowledge about his work. So I was shocked about the truth that I didn't know his name and about his works at all. And the background of his work, you know, the discovery of his work is like this. When Onishi passed away in 1994, Mr. Tadao Ogura, who was the museum director at the Kyoto National Museum of Modern Art, asked a curator at Okayama Prefectural Museum of Art to save all the works left at Onishi's home. Mm-hmm. And the curator followed the instruction and everything was saved, his works. And that was divided into two parts. So one is photography and also ink drawings, which is calligraphy. And Okayama Prefecture Museum, well, it's based in Okayama, Onishi's hometown, kept a body of ink paintings while the curator sent all the photographs to Mr. Kaneko at the Tokyo Metropolitan Museum of Photography. At the time, Mr. Kaneko worked for the museum, Tokyo Metropolitan Museum of Photography, and he was, of course, quite intrigued by the body of photographs by Onishi. And he tried to do something with the work, to introduce, revisit this body of work and exhibit properly. But The thing is, he could not put together an exhibition. The part of the problem was that he couldn't position Onishi in the larger context of Japanese photo history, because he was more known as a painter than photographer. And, you know, there was at the time, nobody knows Onishi as a photographer, and they couldn't place him in any place in Japanese photo history. So after the retirement, Mr. Kaneko took all his photographs to his house, you know, on consignment, of course, with the permission by the Onishi family. And still, he tried to, you know, exhibit his works in some way. And one thing is that he held a show at a commercial gallery in Tokyo in 2014, but nothing happened. And then I came across this group of photographs. That was, I think, 5-6 years ago. And I started the research on the work, and I came to know more about his works, and I really thought it was really fantastic works, and I never knew this type of works ever, you know. So I decided to bring his works to Paris Photo. That was 2017. So we did a small show at our booth, showing about 20 pieces in Paris Photo, the 2017. Then we had a very good reception from museums, American museums, European museums, and luckily we could place some of his works in important museum collections, including Bombay Students Art Center, thanks to Vicente. So that's, to make a long story short, that's what happened, basically.
I would like to go a bit more in depth to what you were speaking about earlier, like this surprise factor about Onishi's work. And I would like to ask you, on a personal level, what struck you the most about his aesthetical and practical approach to photography?
First was the experimental technique he applied, you know, to create the photos. You quoted a part of his essay, and he wrote about his creative process in his essay. He wrote for a photo magazine. That it's really interesting. Let me quote some lines. In terms of techniques, I use multiple exposure, superimposition, printing on photographic paper, prepared with a sponge or a brush, intentional fogging and intentional discoloration with acetic acid. I also occasionally process the film's surface. As for color correction, I generally proceed by varying the temperature during development between 8 and 80 degrees, which is about 45 and 176 degrees in Fahrenheit. As long as the images are not for use in news media or travel promotion, natural changes in color and tone caused by time can be seen as chance elements that bring out different flavors in the images as they age, yeah, end of quote. So it's a quite quite advanced concept concerning photography at that time. You know, it's like a contemporary artist today who uses chance as a creative element. And another point is you know, about his mathematics study. It's very interesting that he said his artwork is his artwork represent his mathematics study. Mm-hmm. So he said, he wrote his thesis is titled Super Infinite. Well, it's some version of a topology, also connected to geometry. It's about construction, spatial construction and dimension. Actually, I read part of his thesis. It's in 10 volumes, actually. And Actually, I couldn't understand at all, but what I could understand is that it's about space, it's about construction, which you can see in his works, you know, with multiple negatives and superimposition of different images and, you know, photo montages, all about, you know, space. And there is also an interesting point, which is there is no instruction about orientation of the image, you know, which side is up and which side is down is a mystery, actually, because in mathematics, there is no up and there is no down. So there is, you know, a lot of interesting elements in his works that interest me, that fascinate me.
Now, and Kaneko also mentioned in his essay that when you were, and now that you brought up his thesis and the work and his research work in topology, that there was a very, that, Shigeru Onishi's work was mentioned in the press, but there was a scarcity of sources that addressed his work. So what research approach did you adopt? So you first went to see also his thesis. What other works did you see? Were there any other catalogs that helped you and guide you in this process of getting to know more about Shigeru Onishi?
Yes, of course. We discovered the archive kept by the Okayama Prefecture Museum for decades, and we retrieved all of them. And we've just started researching on his works, actually, and we are still in the first process of the long journey, actually. And I found in a group of, for instance, exhibition catalogs that introduced his ink drawings mostly in Europe in the 60s and 70s. And that is another story also. Mm-hmm. During the 50s, he met, I explain a bit how he was introduced in Europe in the 60s and 70s. He met Michel Tapie and during the 50s, probably mid 50s. Michel Tapie visited Japan at the time for the research on Japanese artists, especially he was interested in a Gutai group. He was famous. He's famous as a French critic who introduced the Japanese Gutai group for the first time to the Europe. So Onishi met Tapie, and Tapie found Onishi's work quite fascinating. He was so intrigued by his works. However, Tapie was interested in more interested in his calligraphy, ink drawings, than photographs. So he only showed ink drawings in Europe.
Such as like and, the one we're seeing now.
That's right. This is the this is from the monograph Tapie published from his laboratory. It's called International Center of Aesthetics, based in Turin. It's published in the 60s, and Tapie published actually on two or three monographs by Onishi. And one of them is very interesting. This monograph is titled as a super infinite, you know, the title of his thesis. And while some pages reproduce his ink drawings, the most pages reproduce his thesis, only his thesis. You showed on the screen before, you know, part of his thesis. It looks like drawing, actually. You know, he wrote a lot of it's numbers and as you see, it's it doesn't look like this. It looks like a drawing, actually. Yes. So yeah, so because of thanks to Tapie, his Onishi's calligraphy had been widely introduced in Europe at group exhibitions, thematic exhibitions. across Europe, and a few times he also did a show in South America. So that is another part of the research we should do from now.
So it's a continuing process, the research.
Exactly, yes.
Yeah. And I would also, in the frame of this conversation, I would also like to ask Vicente Todolí, with all his accumulated experience and his interest in promoting Japanese photography, which he also mentioned, and as director of Tate Modern, what struck you the most about Onishi's work?
Well, I went to Paris Photo. I used to go, it's the only art fair I used to go, in order to build a collection of Bombaskens, mainly. Bombaskens focuses on photography and also abstract art separately. So when I was walking in the corridor, I saw this image and it got my eye right away. And I said, what is that? So I look at the name of the artist, unknown to me completely. Then I went inside, saw the booth, and I was completely surprised and taken by it. I asked some questions to Katsuya, which I didn't know. We didn't know each other. And then I saw also the book, The Study of Meta Infinite, and I said, wow, this is an amazing artist. So I went to see the collector, who was also visiting. I said, listen, I think we should buy a body of work. We always buy either entire exhibition for photography exhibitions or entire the photographs for entire books. So my idea would have been to buy almost the whole book, which we often do. But then the collector said, okay, I returned and I said, I shot interest in like 8 or 9 photographs, but unfortunately, half of them were already sold or on reserve. I was a little bit slow, but it was unexpected. So I bought that image we see now, that which is the only double image it was in the show. And I think 4 more works. But then I went to Tokyo and just wanted to buy more. So I saw the other works by Onishi. So I think in total we bought 11. And then it's also, I inquired about the ink drawings. And Katsuya said, oh, they are all in storage in a museum. I said, well, we should get them, we have to see them. And we should do a show with both the photographs and the drawings. And what are we going to do? Our show will be double size or more than at foam, because we're going to devote a huge space to the ink drawings. So we'll present both practices, no? And so that we can give a complete, more complete picture of, and for us, it fits completely within our remit, because it's an artist where photography and abstract art go together. And well, also the fact that he was a mathematician, that he started with photographs, then he abandoned photographs, then he started ink drawings, and then he abandoned art and returned to mathematics, to topology. So that full circle, no, really awoke my curiosity and I wanted to know more about the. So every time I went to Tokyo, it was usually twice a year, I would see Katsuya, and we would start looking at what he had found. Finally, he managed to rescue this after some years, these drawings. We were looking at them in the gallery floor, and somehow we said, well, I mean, but there is something here that doesn't work, because we were looking at single sheets of paper. But then suddenly we saw, oh, they are part of a group. The work is composed of many elements. So then the assistant of Katsuya went into the computer, started putting images, and suddenly we compared to the publications, and they are, wow, some of them were like 4 by 6 meters. They are huge. I mean, it took the work to another scale, no? And so I said, well, here we have a unique artist, unknown, and I think that's the mission of museums, to put light in the work of artists that previously, for one reason or another, were unknown. Also, there was not a market. A market is essential today to get to be known, because there is no market, there is no gallery shows, and there is no gallery shows, there is no museum shows. So I can say that still today, when I look at the work, I'm still surprised. It's very mysterious, because in a way, he's working with two opposite directions, like yin and yang, you know, like acidity and sweetness, which is this this structure, which mm-hmm. comes from mathematics, but then the negation of this structure, taking this structure, destroying it, and taking it to absolute freedom. So it reminds me of, there was an exhibition curated by Margaret Rowell at the Guggenheim Museum many years ago about abstract art, and it was called Between Freedom and Discipline. So I think that's what could describe the work of the discipline that comes from mathematics, but the freedom, which is the imagination, and imagination, but also what is inside your body. No, it's a mm-hmm. so in a way, let's say that in order to be creative, you're also in mathematics, you have to have this freedom, to imagine things which previously were not imagined. Mm-hmm. And the fact that he was in the studio, no, and performing, because I think these photographs are the result of the artist performing with his own body and mind, letting it loose. So there is this kind of automatic writing, you could associate with surrealism. Yeah. But also his building by canceling, erasing as part of it, which I guess in mathematics also is part of it, that you have to erase lots of things. Because I remember I had a very close friend who was a mathematician, and she told me, oh, you know, in mathematics, the solution is not the important thing. It has to be an elegant solution. Mm. If it's not elegant, it's not valid. You cannot go around and around and around to find the solution. It has to be straight points. It has to be economical. It has to be beautiful. So the idea of beauty in mathematics, he translated into art.
Yeah, it was the process itself what brought the yes. beauty. Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
But before, because you've also given us some sneak peeks about the exhibition and the production of the exhibition upon the Schens, before we get to that, I would like to talk a bit more about the photographic context surrounding Onishi. So curator Miriam has pointed out that although Shigeru Onishi's work is indeed unique and occupies also a unique position in the history of Japanese photography, such as also what something that Katsuya pointed out and that Kaneko also found out, the difficulty of placing him within a specific movement. Miriam also states that his work doesn't stand alone because he shares a lot of aesthetic common ground with post-war avant-garde photography. So I would like to ask both of you then, how do you value the work of Shigeru Onishi within the framework of history of photography and of Japanese photography in particular? I don't know, would you like to start, Vicente?
Yes, well, I think his work is very unique, although, of course, I see there some common trends with Man Ray, for example, with surrealist photography, but also with the more geometric Bauhaus-derived photography like Boholy Notch. Mm-hmm. Both Boholy and Man Ray, they did photomontage, both they did also diagrams, photograms, so both were also, opening a wound into the standard photography, into the commonplace photography that it was not until then. So they were trying to turn photography into art, you know, because until the moment, very few people, probably only Walker Evans was the one, although he was really more interested in literature. And later, Robert Frank. I see some similarities with the work that Robert Frank did after the 80s, when he took Polaroids, and in the process of developing the Polaroid, he would do some violence into the print so that you would have this kind of abstraction into it, and even write on the negative. So I would say that there is the roots for me would be more into surrealism and Bauhaus, but let's say that he transformed it into something very contemporary, that no other photographer did except Robert Frank later. Because imagine, at the same time, in the 50s, let's say, the only photographer related to painting, to abstract expressionism, was Aaron Siskin. But Aaron Siskin was really taking more graffiti, surfaces, you know. Instead, when I see Onishi working, it reminds me of Jackson Pollock. You know, the famous film of Hans Namuth, where Jackson Pollock is building the paintings on the floor, you know. So that nobody else did. So I would say he's the only artist that used photography in the same way that abstract expressionists like Jackson Pollock, or even in Europe, some practitioners of Latin Formel like Pierre Soulages, no, did. So I think his work is really unique.
Katsuya?
It's quite interesting that Vicente pointed out Jackson Pollock, because Onishi, he played everything in darkroom himself alone, like action painting in a darkroom on a photographic paper. As you see some of his photos, you can recognize the brush stroke. He used developing emulsion as a ink, you know, with a brush in his hands. He made a drawing on the photographic paper freely. That is quite exciting because it involves his physical existence. And talking about his involvement in the historical photographic movement, I explained about the encounter with Michel Tapie in the world of art, fine art, which is paintings. But for photography, you know, his work should be evaluated in the two world, art and photography. So in photography, he was, I don't know if he knew all these artists' works like Bauhaus, Moho Energy, Russian constructivism, whatever, you know, surrealism, probably he knew, of course. But anyhow, that was the older critics, you know, Michel Tapie. And also before Tapie, there was a Japanese art critic, Shuzo Takeuchi, the first discovered him in the 50s. Shuzo Takeuchi was an art critic and surrealist himself, and who introduced the surrealist movement to Japan. And he exhibited his Onishi's works in international subjective photography exhibition in 1956 in Tokyo. That was actually a touring exhibition of subjective photography, originally organized by Otto Steinert in Germany. So Takeuchi also introduced this, one of the people who introduced subjective photography to Japan, and also one of the founders who of the Japanese Subjective Photography League that was founded in 1956. So Takeuchi, the critic, placed his work in the context of subjective photography because he saw many, many common elements with other avant-garde artists or Bauhaus artists. But so the exciting point is that you can see many elements related to international art or photography movement in Onishi's works. That is a really interesting point.
And another one would be also John Cage.
John Cage
was the one using I Ching and
Chen operation, of course,
at the same time. So it's amazing that he could connect all these different researches that were going on. And probably he didn't know any of them, you know, all alone by himself in the studio.
Yeah, that's amazing. Yeah.
Yeah, for the audience, I forgot to mention that during also his study in mathematics, Shigeru Onishi was, before he started, he was also very knowledgeable in I Ching divination, wasn't it, Vicente?
Yes.
And that's why you brought up the whole reference to it as well.
Yeah. And the reivindication of chance as a creative factor. Yeah.
Well, I would now move on to talk a bit about, again, about Perifoto, because as you also mentioned in your introduction, Vicente, when you were talking about Onishi's impact, you know, the impact he made on you, I would say this this edition of Perifoto also marked a cornerstone in the process of reintroducing Shigeru Onishi's prints in the art scene, because through it, not only were you and Miriam Koyman seduced by Onishi's work, but also and acquired prints, but also MoMA acquired as well prints for its collection. However, I would like to know, how did this interest transform into, okay, let's collect some artworks and then go into a concrete exhibition plans that you were talking about just now, Vicente?
Yes, well, usually my way of acting is if an artist is worth collecting, it's also worth showing him in an exhibition, you know? I think they go together, because otherwise you're not doing enough. And more in a case like this, where he was completely unknown. So once I went to Tokyo to see more of the works, I spoke to Katsuya. I said, well, we have to do an exhibition, you know? I mean, because at Bombas Hens, we only show the artists we collect. That's our point. If we don't collect them, we don't show them. That's also our remit is also to show artists we think should be better known and that they're unknown, because you know, more and more some museums are just showing what is known because it brings the audience, and it becomes like a kind of snake that bites its tail. So finally, the known artists, every time they are more known, the unknown have no chance. So we are there precisely to counterbalance that and give an opportunity. Like, for example, we did with Anna Eva Bergman, she was completely unknown. I met her because I went to see the studio of the husband. And then finally, I ended up working with the wife, you know? So that's really what I think we should do, museums should do, yeah.
And besides, I think Onishi's work had stayed too long in the museum depots, not to be shown. And how did your co-curatorship with Miriam Koyman develop in this process?
Well, we did it through the distance because, and then COVID came. So essentially, it's one major selection, and we then got it together. But as I tell you, our show will be also dealing with the ink drawings. You're showing one, so I would we'll show the our 11 photographs more from our collection. So I think people who see the show in Amsterdam should also travel in April 8th. We have the exhibition until the fall, you know, and also they get to know also the amazing works on ink, which are also once. The pictures don't give you an idea. Also, they have color. The size is completely like out of this world. You know, they are compositions, several meters large, made of different sheets of paper in different directions. So that's what we are working now, trying to put them together. They essentially Katsuya and his team, and then soon we have to make the selection and then plan the installation.
And can you share a bit more sneak peeks about the exhibition? What is the focus, the running thread? I would like to know, is it going to be named also the possibility of existence, or does it go by another?
No, we will change it. I still need to discuss that, because since we have included the drawings, a possibility would be to include the idea of Meta Infinite, because that's the book that was published by Michel Tapier. So we still have to find the right title. Because let's say that it will incorporate the exhibition from Amsterdam, from FOAM, but let's say it's like part one, you have there, but then we have part one and part two. You know, it's like a like a film going on. Yeah. And yes, of course, our spaces, which our space which is a former abandoned industrial space. It was a pump factory. You know, it was here. It was abandoned.
It was squatted.
It was burned partially. So José Luis Soler, you know, the owner of the foundation, saw it and decided to restore it. And we asked Annabel Seldorf, the German architect living in New York, who is now in charge of doing the expansion of the free car collection, to come and bring back this place to life, to give it a second opportunity, a second life. So we are also giving a second opportunity to Onishi. Because the first one probably was not even an opportunity. So we hope that after this, really, Onishi's work become essential.
Thank you so much. You also wanted to add something about the photograph that we were just talking about the architectural process of Bombus Rins, just like
yes,
system. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. It was, as I said, the architect Annabel Seldorf who is the author of the restoration of the building, and we even kept the memory. You see, at the end there are two towers. They are the towers from the furnace where they would, cast these pumps. You know, there were these hand pumps. You know that you see in the westerns. You know, yeah. Yeah. And this building was active until the 80s, and in the 80s it was abandoned. Yeah, and now it also is in a quarter that was a working class quarter that suddenly also has had a new life. You know, now people come there, people that never came from the city to this kind of working class quarter. Yeah.
And before we open the floor also for questions from the audience. I would like to ask Katsuya, because sadly, the photography historian Ryūichi Kaneko, which we have referenced constantly during this conversation, recently passed away. What would you like, and that you started a research that is still ongoing, you started it with him, and it's still this process, an ongoing process. I would like to know if you have other future projects in mind, related to Onishi's work. We know now through Vicente that the idea, of course, with the retrospective in Bombus Rins is to give Onishi the position within the history of photography and also in a broader context. So I would like to know if you have anything in mind apart from this upcoming exhibition that you would like to share.
Yes, of course. It was really pity and sad that Mr. Kaneko passed away in the end of June this year. So he was the photo historian of Japanese modern photo from the pre-war period to the present, actually. But he especially specialized in modern photography movement in the 20s, 30s, picture realism, avant-garde, experimental. So I learned a lot from him, and he always gladly gave me a lecture, and he always expect more younger generation of photo historian would participate in this field and explore the possibility of introducing more hidden artists like Onishi. There are still a lot of artists and photographers whom we need to study, to revisit their works and properly introduce. You know, so we continuously take over Mr. Kaneko's research and study, and hopefully to bring more fantastic works to the world.
Maybe do develop, for example, a comparative approach in which you're gonna show the work of Onishi alongside other photographers that are not known and that are also part of the photographic history of Japan.
Yeah, yes, of course. Yeah. Onishi emerged in the 50s, and also we also focus on the early 50s. It was a very important moment in Japan, right after the war, after the suppress to the avant-garde expression, artistic expression during the war by the government. There are lots of artists emerged right after the war who explored any type of experimental artistic expression. And in the field of photography, there are a lot of photo journals also were published right after the war. So also there are several photo movements at the time. One is, subjective photography, experimental photography, avant-garde photography, tradition also continued from pre-war. And also there is a social realistic photo movement too. So everything got together in the time. So there are a lot to explore from now.
That's really exciting to know that there's much more to go for. Also, photo lovers who are here and would like to do more research on Shigeru Onishi's photography and also other Japanese artists. And we've got warm congratulations from an audience. And also one question that Katsuya or Vicente could answer, and is, did Shigeru Onishi produce photo book works? Did he explore book making within this whole experimentation process with photography?
No, I don't think so. He totally concentrated on his artworks and his thesis, not like other Japanese photographers at the time who was fascinated to make books. His interest was completely different.
Yeah, and then he slowly shifted to abstract painting. Of course, that was also referenced by Kaneko, that early on he was already doing abstract painting. It's not something that happened out of the blue, but he decided to focus slowly from photography exploration in the darkroom to ink painting, right?
Yes, yeah. That's right.
Yeah, and then there's this book, this amazing masterpiece, which I consider also an artist book, not a photography book, which is the one published by Michel Tapie in Turin, 1969, A Study of Meta Infinite, which is impossible to find. And I think one day, maybe I tried even to go to Turin and find out the printer, but the printer is not there anymore. So I think ideally this book should be turned into a facsimile in the future, because that's really an amazing work.
And I think it's part of that makes also the challenge of not being able to find that, not having the sources there, adds a bit of spice into the research process, and also value when you are able to do it, you find it and you show that that source. Doesn't it feel that way?
Yeah, the research is still to be done. Also, the research into, the only gallery that showed him in Europe was a very famous gallery. Stadler in Paris. Stadler was the same gallery that showed Antonio Saura and all other practices of informalism. And both Katsuya and I, we're trying to find what's in the archives there. And essentially, also there are works in Europe because they were sold, but we don't know where they are. So that's something we have to, now is the time to do it, so that you get a complete picture also of his presence in Europe.
Yeah, well, I wish you good luck in your endeavors and in this process, and looking forward to see Bomba's Gens exhibition retrospective. It will open on the 8th of April, 2022. So for people who are also tuning in from Spain right now or are nearby, please go pay a visit in the spring. I would like to close by saying that the exhibition at FOAM will be open until the 9th of January as well. So for people also living here, come and see the beautiful prints that you selected with, that Vicente Todolí, Katsuya and Miriam Poyman selected. And we also have this in our bookshop. This is a beautiful book. It's the first publication developed between Mem Gallery and Stedelijk Books. And it's called A Meta-Mathematical Proposition. So you can find it as well on your way out. Thank you very much, Vicente and Katsuya, for joining us today. And I wish you a nice evening.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Bye, everyone. Bye.